28, it says that Mary had come to the tomb early on that first day of the week. And she's talking to this angel, verse 5, Matthew 28, 5. The angel answered and said unto the woman, "Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said." What a blessing. Good to see everyone here. On the calendar, it says Easter Sunday, but we like to call it Resurrection Sunday. The time that we think of Christ returning from the dead. What a special day it is for all mankind. Whether you say, "Well, I don't hold to those things," or "Nah," it's a special day for everybody. We'll talk about that later on today, and we're looking forward to a wonderful children's program here in just a little bit. But before we get there, I'm going to have you do a little bit of singing. We'll turn to 156 in the chorus book. 156, we'll sing, "I've a longing in my heart." Let's stand together. We'll sing that twice and give a chance to welcome somebody nearby. 156. "I've a longing in my heart. Nearby, feel welcome. "I've a longing in my we'll sing that once more as you make your way back to your seats. "I've a longing in my heart for Jesus. I've a longing in my heart to see his face. I am weary, oh so weary, of traveling very long. I've a longing in my heart for him." All right, amen. At this time, if you can remain standing, we're going to have Brother Albert Forgas come and open this special Sunday in prayer.
All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. We thank you for the day that you've given us to come worship you today, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the safety that you've given us all to be here today. Lord, we thank you for this church that you've given us, Lord. We also thank you mostly for sending your son to die on the cross for us, Lord, for our sins, and having him rise again, Lord. Lord, if there is someone here today, Lord, that does not know 100%, Lord, if they were to die today, that they were going to heaven, Lord, we ask you to please allow them to get that settled today, Lord.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You can be seated. But I can tell the kids are ready to come out. So we're going to sing a song while they come out to keep that chorus book that you had, number 194. "Jesus is the sweetest name I know." We'll sing that while the kids come out and get ready with their program. There have been names I have loved to hear, but never has there been a name so dear as Jesus. Number 194 in the spiral bound chorus book. There have been names that I have loved to hear.
Jesus, 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 Jes
right. Well, happy Resurrection Sunday. What a beautiful day. And what I have behind me is our third, fourth, fifth, and sixth graders that come to church. And the last couple of Sundays, we have been working on some songs and some verses. And I think they're waving at all their friends and family members that have joined us today. But today, we have a little bit of a dilemma. And so I need you to listen close and help to see if you can solve the problem. The question mark of our program today is, who was guilty? So I hope that you'll enjoy this special presentation from the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth grade. I also have some of our teenagers in our TNT program, and they've joined in to help us. So we'll get started with who was guilty.
Order. We must have order in this court. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, where you're here today because innocent life has been taken. Sin has been committed and someone must pay. If you have any information regarding this case, please step forward.
Was it Judas selling him for 30 pieces of silver by leading his enemies to the garden?
I betrayed him with the kiss of a friend. Was it I who brought about this master sin?
Matthew 26:45 says, "Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners."
Was it King Herod who wanted to see miracles done?
Jesus came to my court that day. Was I the guilty one that day?
But 1 John 3:16 says, "Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us." He laid down his life for us.
Like many people are guilty, but it also seems like Jesus chose to die that cruel death. This isn't making much sense. There must be more information.
Was it Pilate who said he found no fault in him?
I let Barabbas go free. Is the guilty one me?
Ephesians 5:2 says,
"Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us." And how
job?
We tortured and mocked this guilty one. Did we kill God the Son?
Was it you or me? Were we guilty of killing the Lord Jesus?
Wait, I don't even know why I'm here. I'm innocent. I never killed anyone.
Just received new information regarding this case. According to this, we are all guilty. It says right here, because we have all gone astray and turned to our wicked ways that the Lord laid on him, on Jesus, all of our iniquities. It's beginning to make sense now. We have all done wrong things, and that is why Jesus had to die, to make payment for our sins. But no one took his life. He gave it willingly. In fact, Jesus said, "I lay down my life. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself." Order. We must have order in this court. Listen to this. We are here to find out who is guilty of killing Jesus, but Jesus isn't dead. Listen, Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. That means we're all guilty of sin, but Jesus willingly laid down his life so that we didn't have to pay for that sin. We don't have to pay for our sin or Jesus' death, because he is the only one that could pay for our sin. And he is not dead. He rose from the grave. Ladies and gentlemen, case dismissed. Thank you for coming out for the children's program today. I think they did a wonderful job. Let's give them all a round of applause.
Amen. All right, now they're going to keep going out, and then our church choir is going to come in and try to top that. But we're going to sing a song. Let's go ahead and stand as we sing from our chorus book still, the spiral-bound one, number 127. I was lost in sin, but Jesus rescued me. He's a wonderful Savior to me. 127. I was lost in sin, but Jesus rescued me. He's a wonderful Savior to me. I was bound by fear, but Jesus set me free. He's a wonderful Savior to me. Savior to me. I was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. He's a wonderful Savior to me. He's a friend so true, so patient and so kind. Savior to me. I was bound by him. In him I always find. He's a wonderful Savior to me. For he's a wonderful Savior to me. He's a wonderful Savior to me. I was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. He's a wonderful Savior to me. He is always near to comfort and to cheer. He's a wonderful Savior to me. He forgives my sins. He dries my every tear. He's a wonderful Savior to me. For he's a wonderful Savior. He's a wonderful Savior to me. I was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. He's a wonderful Savior to me. Dearer grows the love of Jesus every day. He's a wonderful Savior to me. Sweeter is his grace while pressing on my way. He's a wonderful Savior to me. For he's a wonderful Savior to me. He's a wonderful Savior to me. I was lost in sin, took me in. He's a wonderful Savior to me. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, amen. That program, that was so good. I enjoyed those little ones so very much. What a blessing. And not just a cute story, but really, it's that story around which all of human history revolves. It's a big deal. It's a big deal. And we're going to try to make much of that today. And every single one of us, Lord, tune our hearts to the importance of the truth of the resurrection. Well, we're glad to see everyone here today. And we're glad to see any guests, any visitors we have with us. The ushers came forward. They have welcome cards, and they have pens to fill it out with. If you're, you don't have to say anything, but if you're with us for the first time, if you wouldn't mind slipping up your hands, they're going to give you the card and a pen to fill it out with. You can keep that pen if you kind of wave at them as they head back. If you'd fill out that card, we'd like to have a record of your attendance, have the opportunity to follow up with you if you'd permit us to do that. We'd appreciate that. In a little while, the offering plate will come by, and you can drop that card in there if it's filled out by then. And if it isn't, then after the service, you can give it to one of the ushers or even to me or one of the fellows you see up here. But we're so glad you're here today. And again, we have come together to make much of Christ. And we actually do that every Sunday morning, but especially as we think about the resurrection on this Easter Sunday. So good to have everyone here today. And then ushers, when you are reset, you can come down once more. This evening, we'll have another church service at 5:30. Looking forward to that. We like to get together several times a week and think about Christ and open the Bible. Wednesday, late morning, will be our Jolly 60s at 11 a.m. That's our seniors. They get together for a good meal and a time of fellowship, a Bible study, and a fun activity. This last week, they assembled like 23 Easter baskets to kind of give out today on the buses and in the junior churches. So they like to keep themselves busy doing wonderful things. And so that's a lot of fun. Thursday evening is our midweek service at 7 p.m. And then Friday evening is our RU recovery program at 7 p.m. as well. Brother Fletcher, would you mind coming and ask the Lord's blessing on the offering this morning?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, just for your Son, Lord, and your willingness to send him to die on the cross, Lord, for our sins, Lord. And I thank you for letting him rise on the third day, Lord. And God, we just thank you that we serve a living Savior, Lord. And God, I just pray that you bless this offering and give us a good day in your house, Lord. Praise things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
let's take our hymnals now and stand together as we sing number 475, 475, Redeemed. How I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, 475 in the hardback hymnal. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Amen. Boy, I've enjoyed everything leading up to right now, all the music and just everything, and even listening to you guys sing, it's been a blessing this morning. Let's turn our Bibles to 1 Corinthians 15. We actually heard some verses from here that were quoted in the program, 1 Corinthians 15. Boy, Easter. Americans, I read, are expected to spend more than $3 billion on Easter candy this year. I don't know if that worries the dentists across this land of ours or encourages them. You know, they can make their yacht payments or however that goes, right? Some interesting Easter traditions around the world. I saw that in New Zealand, they eat hot cross buns on Easter. Okay, good. In Norway, they crack out the crime novels and start reading the crime novels every Easter. I'm not sure what the association is there. In Bermuda, they fly kites. That's exciting, you know. In Australia, where rabbits are considered a nuisance, they'll eat instead chocolate bilbies, which is a little mammal, I guess, distinct enough from a bunny rabbit that it doesn't bother them as much. But anyway, I'm glad you're here today as we look at God's Word regarding Easter, Resurrection Sunday. I went up to my son this morning and gave him a big hug, and I'm like, I get to preach the resurrection today. What a blessing. And all over this world, there are churches. Of course, with the different time changes in Phnom Penh, they had their service in Cambodia there hours and hours ago. We were praying about that last night. But all over the world, the resurrection of Christ is being lifted up. And may it be that every year we grow older, we have a little bit deeper understanding of why it matters so very much that our Lord is alive. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, it says, moreover, brethren. So here, we're actually talking to believers. So it's important that believers understand the importance of the resurrection. Did you know the resurrection is important for believers and unbelievers alike? So today it's not, this is for the lost. No, this is for every one of us. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. So I'll draw our title from there, right there. I declare unto you the gospel. I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which ye also have received. That's an important word, received. That's an important word with having the right relationship with the resurrection. And wherein ye stand. By the which also ye are saved. I don't know, maybe you've heard that word before. You're like, are you saved? Are you lost? I don't even know what that means. Well, today is a good day to figure out what it means to be saved. It has something to do with the gospel. And then the gospel has everything to do with the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. By the which ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. So it doesn't matter how spiritual, this is the Apostle Paul. Like, well, the gospel, that's for the dirty, rotten sinners. This is the Apostle Paul said, I'm only set because I received the gospel. I received it. It's for every one of us. Which I also received, how that? So here he is. He gives us what the gospel is. Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, and that he was buried. And that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. That's why we're here today. And really, that's why we assemble every Sunday morning, the first day of the week. Because on the first day of the week, Christ rose. And that's why every Sunday, the doors of churches that belong to the Lord God all over the world are opened. And the word of God is proclaimed and Christ uplifted. Well, I'm a Baptist.
and I like to eat. There's going to be some food at some point later on today. And one of my favorite restaurants in the Chicago area, Claim Jumpers. Alas, they closed their doors. They were up in Lombard. I was watching a video of a guy. Somebody was going through and videoing the empty Claim Jumpers and shooting video in through the windows there. But it was so good up there in Illinois by Yorktown Mall. They had a grand rustic out west theme and great portions, giant desserts. So it was kind of an out west theme, a Claim Jumpers, one of their desserts. And there's still several locations, but they're out more out west now. But one of their desserts was called the Chocolate Motherlode. And to see this chocolate cake, fudge in there, 6 decadent layers. I mean, just to cut a slice out and then lay it on your plate, you have to have kind of a platter just for the slice to lay there. Another one of their desserts from years ago was called the I Declare. I Declare. And it was a giant eclair cake. And it was marvelous. And it was called I Declare. Well, you know, down here on this earth, we get excited about some things that don't last. But I got something better for us to get excited about today. And I can tell you it lasts forever. Instead of I declare, referring to a giant eclair cake, I want to declare something way better to you, the gospel. What did he say here? I declare unto you the gospel. Amen for that. Let's pray and then we'll take some time looking at it. Lord, we love you. And oh God, thank you for sending your son to die for us. And we're so glad as the judge stood up and said, guess what? Good news. He didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead. Oh God, we're excited about that. And I know, Lord, that it has to do with everybody. I'm a Buddhist. No, they need to turn from those things to Christ. Whatever religion somebody seems to follow, Lord, the Lord Jesus is the answer for every human being. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by the Lord Jesus. And Lord, he rose from the dead, and we're so grateful for that. As we look at this passage today, please open our hearts, open our minds. Help us to hear supernaturally the truths. Oh God, I want to preach, but I pray that as I open my mouths, it would be your words, your Holy Spirit working in hearts that are moving people today. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Today we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He came to earth and he willingly gave up his life. No man took his life from him. He gave his life as the penalty for our sins, and he did not stay dead. He was buried in accordance with Scripture and rose again after 3 days. Hallelujah! Now, the resurrection has to do with two types of people, two groups of people on this earth. And you'll find that the two groups are all-inclusive, every human being. So the resurrection has to do with those that are saved. They're saved because of the resurrection. And those who still need to be saved. But can I tell you, their time is running out. Only on this side of death can we make sure we have the right relationship with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If we enter into eternity without having turned to the risen Lord, it will be too late. It's important for all. I want to give 3 things about the resurrection today. 1, I want to talk about the subject of the resurrection. What is it? I want to take some time there. Then secondly, I want to discuss the standing. Those that are trusting in the risen Lord, what does it mean to us? Remember, this passage was addressed. It says, moreover, brethren. He's talking to saved people. I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand. Well, I want to talk about the standing that believers have because of the resurrection. And then the last thing, I want to talk about the seriousness of this topic. For those who do not yet understand how important the resurrection is, or maybe there are some who do understand, but they're like, I'm not going to turn to those things just yet. Maybe someday. Oh, no. Oh, I hope that today is that day. The seriousness of this topic of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So, the resurrection, I declare unto you the gospel, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So first of all, let's look at the subject of the resurrection. What is it? Now, some that know a little bit about the Bible, they say, so wait, Jesus came back from the dead. I mean, I guess that's special, but if I remember correctly, he wasn't the only one. Weren't there others that came back from the dead in the Bible? What sets his coming back from the dead apart? It just seems like that was one of many occurrences of such things. So let's look at that first. There were three that I thought of in the Old Testament that returned from the dead. One was raised by Elijah with the power of God, of course. One was raised by Elisha with the power of God again. And there was even one fellow, this was really interesting. Some men were, I suppose it was their friend. They had their friend had died, and they were taking their friend to go bury him. And as they were going to bury him, some enemy soldiers were on the horizon, apparently rushing toward them. And they were like, we have to do this fast. And so the Bible says in 2 Kings verses chapter 13, 2 Kings 13, verses 20 and 21, it says, and Elisha died, and they buried him, and the bands of the Moabites invaded the land at the coming of the year. So that the Moabites, the enemies, are coming. And it came to pass, as they were burying a man, that behold, they spied a band of men, and they cast the man into the sepulcher of Elisha. They were like, we have to hurry this up. And so the Bible says they cast him into the sepulcher of Elisha. And when the man was let down and touched the bones of Elisha, he revived and stood up on his feet. So I can only imagine this guy. You know, they're going to go bury him. They're like, soldiers, they toss him in. He touches the body, the bones of Elisha, and he comes back to life. I can only imagine what starts running through his mind. I would like to think that the enemy didn't come and take him out again, just right, you know, that'd be awful. I don't know, he's like, those guys are taken off. Hey, fellas, what's going on? You're alive? Anyway, it's pretty amazing. So there were some that returned from the dead in the Bible. How about the New Testament? Jairus' daughter returned to life in Luke chapter 8 through the power of God. Lazarus in John 11, the Lord said, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus broke free from death only by the power of God and came forth. Tabitha was another one in Acts chapter 9. She returned from the dead. Eutychus in Acts chapter 20, he returned from the dead. And we need to park there for a minute. Why did Eutychus die? Well, he was at church. And he was in the window. And he fell asleep. And he was in the window. It seems like there was a second story or something. He fell out and he died. And through God's power, they were able to bring him back from the dead. And so anyway, just a warning to all of you that are, you know, starting to zone already. You were like, the children's program was great. All of that. It's like, now to catch up on some shut-eye. No, stay awake. The warning of Eutychus there. All right, so what's the difference? Well, I need you to understand there's a gigantic difference. Though these returned from the dead, none of them were resurrected. They were miraculously resuscitated. Each and every one of them eventually died after they were resuscitated. This was no resurrection. Eutychus lived for a while and then died. Tabitha lived for a while and then died. That fellow that touched Elisha's bones lived for a while and then died. The two young men that were raised under Elijah and Elisha, they lived for a while. They died. Lazarus in John 11, he lived for a while. And he died. Jairus' daughter, she lived for a while. And she died. These were no resurrections. But guess what? Jesus did not just live for a while and then die. He was resurrected, never to die again. Oh, this is wonderful. 1 Corinthians 15, 20 through 21. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. Because Jesus, the first fruits of the resurrection, because of that one day, all mankind will be resurrected. The Bible says this, John 5, verses 28 and 29. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. There is a future resurrection because of Christ's resurrection. This resurrection will include all human beings, some to life, those that have obeyed the gospel, and some who die in their sins, unto eternal death and damnation. Boy, Jesus rose from the dead. The Bible tells us that this set him apart from everybody. Romans 1, 4 says, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. His was special. So the subject of the resurrection, boy, it is essential to the gospel. Let's talk about that for a little bit. The resurrection, the death, the burial, the resurrection essential to the gospel. And is the gospel important to us? Well, Paul said this in Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Oh, there's that word again. Saved, salvation. I hear people talking about, what does it mean? That's what we're talking about. Understanding the gospel and trusting in the risen Lord of the gospel. That's what salvation is. It is the power of God unto salvation, unto everyone that believeth. Believeth. Yes, Christ died for our sins. But we have to trust in what he did. If I don't trust in what he did, then I enter eternity and I must pay for my own sins forever and ever. The gospel sounds important. What is it, we ask? Well, here in our text, he told us, didn't he? Here in 1 Corinthians 15, at the very beginning again, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which is preached unto you, which ye also have received, and wherein ye stand. Verse 3, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scripture. The Bible says they received the gospel. They received the gospel. That's an important Bible word. Let's talk about the gospel for a minute. Here in Romans 10, you don't have to turn there, but unless you want to, you can write it down. But Romans 10, 9, 10, and 13, it says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart. It's not magic words. It's confessing. I understand who Christ is and what he did for me and how much I personally needed him, because I am that sinner that he died to save. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That God hath raised him from the dead. Do you see how important the resurrection is? Salvation only comes through that. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. They received the gospel. The Bible talks about that in John 1:12. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So last thing, we're looking at the subject of the gospel. Last thing here, so you're like, so it kind of sounds like a big deal. I don't know, Easter has always been, you know, some Cadbury eggs. Other, you know, family get-together, food, Easter egg hunts. Who's going to find the egg with the $10 bill in there? You mean Easter? There's something far, far, far more important about this day? Yes. Yes. The resurrection is everything. Here in the middle of this chapter, let me read a little bit of this here. In 1 Corinthians 15, let's go to verse 12. Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? So Paul's going to bring us, remember in that movie, It's a Wonderful Life? Remember that one? And Jimmy Stewart was able to see what the world would be like if he never existed. Remember that? And he was so glad he woke up from that moment. Oh, it's way better. I don't want to enter into that hypothetical. Well, way far, far worse. Paul's going to enter into the hypothetical. He's going to say, let's look at a world where Christ never rose. And let's let that horror sink in for a minute. Some were denying the resurrection. Earlier in this chapter, Paul says over 500 people saw the risen Lord. Over 500 people saw him. He arose bodily, not invisible. The Bible tells us in John chapter 20, verses 27 through 28, that Thomas even touched him and said, my Lord and my God. He arose bodily. So why were there some who were denying it? Because it didn't fit what they believed. Boy, our belief system changes so much. Even Lazarus, the Bible says in John chapter 11 that Lazarus came back from the dead. And the religious leaders, instead of adjusting their beliefs to the fact that Christ was the resurrection and the life, they figured out how to destroy the proof. In John chapter 12, verse 10, the Bible says, but the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus to death. Oh, why were some denying the resurrection of Christ? Because it didn't fit what they believed. And some people refused to adjust their belief to the truth. And that's why some will enter eternity Christless and in hell forever and ever. Oh, don't be so wrapped up in what you prefer to believe that you won't let it be adjusted to the truth of God's word. We enter into what if Christ never rose? Verse 13. But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ be not risen, then is our preaching vain, empty, meaningless. When Pastor Olson gets up and he talks about hope, when he preaches, talking about encouragement out of God's word, none of that means anything if there's no resurrection. When Dr. Vogelin takes us, through that next section of whatever book he's preaching through, and draws out the truth and gives us application to live by, none of that means a thing. Not a thing if there is no resurrection. And your faith is vain also. I at funerals. I've preached lots of funerals, and there in 1 Thessalonians 4:18, at the end I'll say, oh, I'm so glad if the person entered eternity knowing the Lord as their Savior. I'm so glad to say, and listen, we sorrow not as others that have no hope. Because of the truth of God's word, we know where they are. We have hope. Oh, but if Christ never rose, there is no hope. And we may as well sorrow like anyone else. Verse 15, yea, and we are found false witnesses of God. We're just a bunch of liars that stand up and talk about the Bible. Because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, and ye are yet in your sins. There's no cleansing. No forgiveness. I have to enter eternity and pay for my own sin. An eternity of hellfire. And the Bible says, oh, beware of sin. There's pleasure only for a season. And you say, well, at least there's a season of pleasure. At least I get that little bit. I'm in my sins anyway. If Christ be not raised, why try to live a clean life at all? Verse 18, then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. Those love my dad knew Christ as his Savior. And I was, the Lord took him home in 2002, and I'm looking forward to see him again. But if Christ be not raised, he isn't there. And I'm not going to see him someday. Oh, no, please say it's not true. I want to wake up from this nightmare. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Verse 20, but we can wake up from the nightmare. But now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. Glory to God! Glory to God! Jesus is risen because of Calvary and because of the empty tomb. My burden is gone. And the preaching is not in vain. By the way, if Christ is not risen, then is our preaching vain. But if Christ is risen, then this preaching has something to do with it. How important is the preaching to you? Because Christ is risen. The subject of the resurrection. Secondly, the standing of those who have trusted Christ already. I think many in this room have understood the importance of the resurrection and have thrown themselves on the importance of the truth that Christ died for my sin. And I have no hope of eternal life without Christ. Some have seen that. But let's look for the, what does it mean? May it be that if you know the Lord as your Savior, every Easter, the resurrection only becomes more dear, and your life is shaped differently as you grow in the understanding of the importance of it. 1 Corinthians 15:1, moreover, brethren, he's talking to saved people, I declare unto you the gospel, which I also preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein ye stand. Thanks be to God. I remember growing up, my pastor growing up, often we would sing the chorus of Thank You, Lord. It's in our blue hymnal, page 221. Thank you, Lord. The verse, there's three verses, but verse one starts with, some thank the Lord for friends and home, for mercy sure and sweet, but I would praise him for his grace. In prayer, I would repeat. I remember we would always sing these words growing up. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich and free. You know, it's easy to forget how costly our salvation was. We can take things for granted so easily, can't we? I think of the man who was drunk. He was drunk and kind of walking through the night. He's not thinking clearly and he's upset and he doesn't even know why. He goes and he's walking and he sees a house and he goes, look at that nice house. It's a nice house. Why do other people have nice things? Look at that nice house that somebody has. It's probably full of nice things. And why do other people get to have nice houses? Nice. It doesn't look like anyone's home. Maybe I'll just go and take some of those nice things. So he wandered over and broke in and found a pillowcase and started stuffing it with some of those nice things. And sure enough, the house was empty. He's like, now I have these nice things. And why does he get to have this nice house? And you know what? Nobody's here. I'm going to burn it down. So he sets to lighting the house on fire. He stumbles out and finds some ditch to sleep in for the night. The next day, he wakes up with that hangover. Oh, gets his pillowcase, and he goes, well, I guess I'm going to head home. Starts heading to his house, only to discover someone had burned it down that night. In his drunkenness, he failed to recognize he was looking at his own house and robbing himself. You know, sometimes the poison of drunkenness, of ungratefulness, causes us not to realize what we have in Christ. Oh, often when my wife deals with a lady that's going through turmoil, when I'm going through one of the men that's going through something awful, you know what? You know, it often harkens back to this one thing. Not grateful for who I have in Christ and what I have because of him. Our standing. In the end of 1 Corinthians 15, let's go all the way back to verse 51. 1 Corinthians 15, 51, it's going to talk about the resurrection for a little bit. So 1 Corinthians 15, 51, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. It's talking about that resurrection body. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. And we shall be changed, for this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Three times we're going to see that word victory right here. Here is one. Oh, death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So many believers are acting like they're trodden down and weighed down by, I'm a Christian, and it's hard to live this life, please. Oh, God has given us the victory. Live victoriously. And it starts with being grateful for who Christ is and what you have because of him. And then he says in verse 58, therefore, because of this, here's what you should be doing. Because of the resurrection, this is the life that we should be seeing. My beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Be steadfast, that first thing there. Be stable for Christ. Be steady. Boy, at work, be hardworking and honest, be steady. whether you're at church or at home, at work or at play, there's a steadiness. You live like God matters 24/7, 365 or 366 on years like this. Not as children tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine, like it says in Ephesians 4:14, be steadfast, be steady. The resurrection should allow Christians to live a steady life. Secondly, be unmovable, stand. Stand, be steady, and stand. Ephesians 6:11, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The devil can't turn you to flight in the day of battle because of the resurrection. Be steadfast, unmovable, and then always abounding in the work of the Lord. Work. So be steadfast, stand, and then serve. Christ is alive, and that's why I serve. I serve. The choir sang it, didn't they? 132 in our blue hymnals is, He lives. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. And what's the opening words of that hymn? I serve a risen Savior. 1 Corinthians 15:34, awake to righteousness. Remember, he's talking to believers. Awake, Christian, wake up. Christian, won't you wake up? You're in this slumber. Wake up. And this is the context of the resurrection. Don't slumber in spiritual darkness. Live in the light of the truth of the resurrection. Awake to righteousness and sin not. Be clean. Be sanctified. Live like the family you've been allowed to join in salvation. And then he says, this is 1 Corinthians 15:34, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. What you have because of the resurrection, some do not. Wake up! And live out the importance of the resurrection and live your life helping others to see that they need to be saved as well and trust in the risen Lord. And then lastly, this one's short, the seriousness of this topic. The seriousness, some don't understand the importance of Resurrection Sunday. Maybe, oh, I thought Easter was Easter bunnies. I thought Easter meant something. Oh, Easter is Resurrection Sunday. Maybe there are some that I never knew what it meant to be saved, but I see it now. Or maybe there are some that I did know, and I was putting it off. Don't. Don't. Romans 1:16, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. It's a big deal. Can I read you another one? Here in 2 Thessalonians 1:8-9, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Did you hear that? In flaming fire. Taking vengeance on them that know not God, that obey not the gospel. Those that would sit and say, I hear about the preciousness of the gospel, but it's not for me. Oh, I want these words to frighten you. Because if they do and you turn, you'll be grateful for these words for all of eternity. Who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. So what is the gospel? Paul told us in Romans 1, it's the power of God unto salvation. Paul told us again in 2 Thessalonians, oh, those that obey not the gospel, oh, it's awful on the other side of death. What is the gospel? Let's talk about it one last time. 1 Corinthians 15 told us what it is. 1 Corinthians 15, 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which ye also have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ, God's dear Son, God the Son, the only begotten Son of God, Christ, died. Why did he die? For our sins, the Bible says. Because each and every one of us are sinners, according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures. Mark 1:15 says this, and saying, the time is fulfilled, the gospel, or the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Repenting has the idea of turning. Turning. And I think sometimes in our life, we're doing this, and we're heading to, that's what I want. It only makes sense to go toward what I want. I'm going toward what I want. And then God miraculously allows you to see the gospel, see the importance. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. And God allows you to see that instead of this way, there's the way God wants me to be on. And I think as we go this way, our heads get turned. God miraculously turns the head of every person so they can see the path they should be on. And then it's up to you to decide if you're going to join your head and go that way. Or, oh, interesting. But that's what I want. Regardless of what the Bible says about there being a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Oh, praise God. When I was a little boy, there was a man preaching, and I was a little boy, and I was going my way, and the preacher preached, and the Holy Spirit of God turned my head so that I could see the way, the way, the truth, and the life, the Lord Jesus Christ, and how much I needed him. God turned my head, and in that moment, I chose to turn. Lord, I want that path instead. What does it say there? Mark 1:15, and saying the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Turn to Jesus from your sin and trust in the risen Lord for cleansing from your sin and eternal life. You know what? Sometimes when you face death, there's been pictures, or there's been stories of wealthy people. I've got money. Life is good. I've got money. All I need is I've got money. That's all that matters to me. I've got money. Then they go to the doctor and they find out they have cancer. And then suddenly, I don't care about money. Face to face with death, my only concern is life. Face to face with death, my only concern is life. Boy, there Lazarus had died in John chapter 11, and Martha came to Jesus, and they were face to face with death, and this was a great time for Jesus to talk about eternal life. Here's what he said in John 11:25. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. We don't live in the land of the living, heading to the land of the dying. Down here, we're in the land of the dying, getting ready for the land of the living. A saved person who is up in years isn't gearing up for the end. He's gearing up for the beginning. It's not that life is almost over. It's that life is just beginning. And you can only know that life through the Lord Jesus. So Titus, last night, Titus was at men's prayer. And he's got a carton of eggs, you know. Of course. I was wondering why other people didn't have their carton of eggs. But he had a special carton of eggs. It was a purple carton of eggs, and on the top it said resurrection eggs. And I kind of had an idea of what that was. Sometimes they'll use resurrection eggs. They'll open up the carton of eggs and they'll pull out an egg and open it up, and inside there'll be a little cross. A little this, a little that, a little nail to tell the story of Jesus dying on the cross. And of course, you open up an egg and you tell a little bit more of the resurrection story. And you open up another egg and you tell a little bit more of the resurrection story until you get to the final egg. Everyone's slid forward in their seats in anticipation. What's going to be in there? And you open it up and it's empty. Of course, maybe if you didn't see it coming, the kids are like, oh, how disappointing. But no, that reminds us how precious the empty tomb is. That Jesus is no longer there. What does the empty tomb mean to you today? What have you done with the risen Lord? I declare unto you the gospel. Would you close your eyes and bow your heads?